Pioneer, leader, champion. Tony DiCicco was all of that, but more importantly to him was that he touched countless lives during his seminal American soccer journey. The Connecticut native was an All-American goalkeeper at Springfield College, but his great calling was coaching. An assistant coach for the U.S. Women's National Team that won the first World Cup in 1991, Tony took over as head coach 3 years later. He was advised to pursue a career in the men's game, but Tony really loved the challenge. So instead, he inspired a group of young players to become stars and help him raise the women's game to unimaginable heights, winning the gold medal at the 1996 Atlanta Games, and then the epic triumph on home soil at the 1999 Women's World Cup. Tony's soccer mission didn't end there. He served as the commissioner of the WUSA, led the United States to the Under-20 World Cup title in 2008, and added his immeasurable expertise to soccer broadcasting. A beloved member of the Fox Sports family, he was on the call for the 2015 Women's World Cup final, joining me and Cat Whitehill.
I know in 1999, we felt greater pressure leading to the final.
It was fitting that Tony would be there in Vancouver when the U.S. team he loved so much ended a 16-year drought since his great team lifted that trophy. Tony DiCicco loved his family, his players, and a beautiful game. Memories of his great victories will always be with us, and his legacy will live on forever. From Hall of Famers to young girls, and yes, boys too. Indeed, anyone kicking a soccer ball and dreaming big all across America. Rest in peace, Tony.
That fine video was done by Fox Sports. Thank you very much. And JP Del Camera, you'll recognize that voice. Great to see everyone. I am Julie Foudy, and
Pioneer.
And that is the video again. And I was lucky enough to play for Tony DiCicco for over a decade. As many of these fine women here in attendance tonight also did. Actually, can we actually have the national teamers from the various phases stand up? Come on, women. Yeah. Recognizes Tony for a world championship, an Olympic gold medal, and another world championship in 99, a Hall of Fame coaching career, and how he was so brilliant with his X's and O's and tactics. But what's always fascinating and interesting and so special to me is when we talk about Tony, we don't talk about any of that. We talk about how he was a great friend. He was a great mentor. He was all these things. He was a teacher. He was a businessman, a broadcaster. I mean, he had so many different facets of his life, as many of you are familiar with in this room. And that is really what we want to do today. We want to celebrate and honor Tony and his legacy and walk you through some of the different journeys of his life. And of course, we're going to cry some. And hopefully we'll smile a lot through those tears as well, because that was always Tony. He'd walk out onto the fields, and the thing I always remember, he'd walk out and he'd look up into the sky with his arms raised and he'd say, "I love my job," with a grin and laughter. And that's how we started practice, with that joy and that enthusiasm and that passion for life. So without further ado, we start first with the president of this fine university, who, by the way, is the first woman president, which Tony would love. First woman president, first Hispanic president here at Central Connecticut State University, and has been tremendous in providing all the facilities for us today. Dr. Toro.
Good afternoon and welcome to Central Connecticut State University. It's an honor for us to serve as the host for this very special gathering today to celebrate the life of Tony DiCicco. Tony meant many things to many different people. At CCSU, we are proud to call him an alumnus, a coach, and most importantly, a very dear friend. As many of you may know, Tony received his master's here at Central in 1980 while working with Coach John Webster and the men's soccer team in that era. Tony's brother, Bob, has served for a long time here as a professor in our Department of Mathematics. Tony also served as an assistant coach with Mick D'Arcy for our women's soccer team this past season. It was indeed a privilege for those two different generations of Blue Devil student athletes to learn firsthand from the most successful coach in the history of U.S. soccer. Well, we welcome you all with open arms today. It is bittersweet to be the venue for this final homecoming for Coach DiCicco, his family and friends. We too are deeply saddened by his loss and the void he left for so many of us in the CCSU. We are humbled to offer our home to you all today as a place to share memories about a beloved coach, colleague, mentor, friend, father, and brother. I offer my sincere condolences to Tony's family, to his wife Diane, and his four sons. On behalf of the CCSU family, our thoughts and prayers are with you at this difficult time. Thank you for sharing Tony with us.
Welcome everyone to CCSU to celebrate my father, Tony DiCicco's life. You know, as I stand here before you, and I look out into the crowd and just see chapters of a lifetime, different groups of people coming together. My mind's going in every direction it possibly can. Waves of emotion sweeping over all of us. But since my father's passing, and even in the time leading up to it, I've felt such a strong connection to my father in my heart, his presence in this room. And it is in that place that the thoughts, the overwhelming emotions, whatever it is, fall away, and there's a peace, a stillness, a love that's barely fathomable from this space and time. And as I struggle to find the words, you know, in recent weeks we've talked about how words come up short of describing these emotions of the heart. And so mostly I'm excited to celebrate my father with all of you. I know that he played an integral role in all of our lives. And as we do that, I just ask that mindfully you hold him in your heart. I know that he's there. I know you'll find him there. As my father marched through his journey, a beautiful journey in this life, he had a gift. He had many gifts, but he had such a special quality in seeing the potential and the power in each of you, in each of us. And true to Tony fashion, true to my father's fashion, he waited until his final days and moments to fully remember who and what he was and recognize his true power and potential. And because of the time constraints, the only story that I'll be able to share with you, and there'll be plenty more, is that of the final days of my father's life. I've said it before, but they were the best days of my life. To share it with my mother, Diane, with Anthony, Alex, Nicole, Nick, Lauren, and many others, to feel the love that cascaded over our family and continues to, has been such a gift, such a blessing. When we allow it to, with all its imperfections, my father's journey has been perfect. That's how I feel about my father. In those final days, we created a sacred space in our family home. My father traveled the world with many of you, celebrating victories, consoling during defeats, but he never forgot where he was from, Wethersfield, Connecticut, born and raised, the joys of his youth, his evolution and growth into a young man and into the career that many of us know him for, and to return to that space felt like the greatest accomplishment of his life, because we all set about to support him and remain in the process that he was in. We understood that the process, the path to healing, and the path to transcendence were actually always the same path. And it was just a matter of how it would go on this physical plane. In each of my brothers offered so much to my father, carried themselves, my mother carried themselves with such grace, and Tony was teaching us, even in those final days, how to do it the right way. I would touch him on his heart chakra, his heart, and I would tell him, "Dad, we're with you. We love you. We're not bracing for anything. We're willing to walk this path with you, in your heart, with you in ours, wherever it takes us." And I held my father in his final moments. It's a special time in my life. And for all the challenges that we faced as a family, I never could have foreseen the beauty in my father's passing. And in those final moments, my father looked up and his life force, this is literally what I observed, but his life force radiated through his skin and through his face, as that was where I was focusing. And he was at peace. All of us were around him by his side. And he surrendered his last breath back to God. I feel his love. I know that I'll always be able to find him in my heart. And I encourage you to look for him there as well in difficult times. I love you, Dad. And it would be very important for him, to honor him, to express to all of you how much you mean to my father, to my family, and how much it means to us to come and celebrate his life today. Thank you.
next speaker is George Purgavie. George Purgavie shared goalkeeping duties with Tony when they played for the Connecticut Wildcats in 1974. After that season, they were roommates in Ludlow, Vermont, where they found a way to balance their teaching jobs with their love for finding crazy adventures. Please welcome George Purgavie.
Until my knees totally wore out. And I think he kept a lot of the players, you know, moving on the field as well. Great surgeon. First of all, I just wanted to, you know, express my condolences to the family and say how much I really love Tony. He was a really great friend and a very important part of my life. We played. And I graduated from college and ended up going up to play for the Wildcats. We were the two goalkeepers. I remember one of the people who was at the Hartford Current wrote an article called Roommates on the Road. And we always laughed about that a little bit. But I remember one night we were playing the Boston Astros, and afterwards we decided to go to Vermont. And so we got in Tony's truck, which was an old Ford 150 with an 8-track. And, you know, we took off, and usually Tony would have something on like, you know, it's Colorado Rocky Mountain High. And we really liked John Denver at that point in our lives. So early on, he convinced me to go up to Vermont and live up there. We get a place in Ludlow. He had a teaching job in Bellows Falls. I had a teaching job in Londonderry and actually Green Mountain Union High School for a little bit. And so we lived, skied. I didn't ski very well, but Tony was a great skier. I fell down a lot. So he kept on picking me up, and eventually I didn't fall down too much. But we had some great experiences up there, and you know, as Tony was so organized and such a, you know, a real visionary, I was just the opposite, basically. I was a nightmare, and Tony and I, there were a few mishaps, and those are the stories I'm going to share with you. Everybody knows how great a soccer person is, but I'll never forget. I did a couple of things. I backed over his brand new Craftsman tool set and in the driveway. We were living in this chalet that was owned by a guy named Jim Gia. And he had a wife. We didn't know her name, so we just called her Carmen. Jim and Carmen Gia. So we were living there, and our coach with Wildcats was a great goalkeeper coach. He really was. He had been the goalkeeping coach for Ajax and taught us an awful lot. You know, beat our bodies into the ground. And he was coming up for a visit, you know, and his name was Renee. And so anyway, he comes up and, you know, Tony's got a teach the next day, and he goes, and Tony and I just got these brand new Peugeot bikes. One of his buddies went to a bike shop and we got these Peugeot bikes. Awesome. And so he says, hey, why don't you and Renee go out for a ride? And I said, great idea. But maybe it wasn't a great idea, because we took off, Renee and I took off from the chalet, and if you don't know much about a chemo, but you come down the mountain and there's a couple of turns that can be challenging. And so Renee and I are like bugs in our teeth, you know, breeze in our face, look like, mommy, mommy, you know, my ponytail's too tight. And so anyway, we get down, we're going past this little pond on the right. It's just a beautiful day, fall. And then we realize that there's a hairpin turn. And so we start to try to slow down, but we're going pretty fast. And so anyway, we make the first hairpin turn there, and then there's another hairpin turn going back in the other direction. And not wanting to kill myself, I laid the bike down on its side like this, and Renee was behind me. And a little road rash began then. And then all of a sudden I felt this. And Renee rode right over my body into the woods. Okay, and of course, the bikes were not in great shape at that point, and we were at the bottom of the mountain. We had to climb back up, so we both looked like we were in a motorcycle accident. So we walked the bikes back up. Long story short, we get there, we finally get to the chalet. We go somewhere and get bandaged up. You know, we look like mummies because they had, you know, all these bandages all over us. And so Tony gets back from school and he goes, "Hey, how was the ride?" And we walk out and he goes, "What the hell happened to you two guys?" And my first thing I said was, "Okay, you might as well know right now, we ruined the bikes." And that was basically my role with Tony, was to ruin most of everything he had. And so anyway, that was one story we had that was, and they were really shiny bikes too. And then, one of the other things I want to share with you was, you know, Tony was, besides soccer, he was really into the outdoors. He loved the outdoors. He and I used to climb Scutney, and we would walk, run down with ski poles, you know, work on our lateral movement, and great times, and, you know, we'd be singing John Denver along the way. And so, anyway, we both really got into some cool stuff. Like, there's this thing called Project Challenge, which is like Project Adventure. And, you know, we were in this program, and so it was making ropes course and working with kids who had behavioral issues and stuff, and, you know, teachers being delayed by kids who, you know, basically the teachers didn't like. And so, you know, builds a little bit of character. And then, one day, Tony and I get this great idea. He goes, "George, let's get the faculty at Floodbrook and the faculty at Bells Falls Middle School together, and we'll take them to the ropes course and do some initiative tests and stuff, and some high ropes." So we did. And of course, as we come around to the high ropes, there's the 14-foot wall. And we're all standing there, and people who would participate. Remember, these are teachers, or some of them in their 50s, 60s, women, you know, and very proper. And so anyway, we decided to get over the 14-foot wall. And Tony and I, and another guy, Jay Joseph, we go up and try to get up first, because we figure we can help people along the way from up there. And we do, until it comes to the last person, which is this guy, DeCoy, who was a Russian teacher, said, "I'll be the last person." And so Tony goes, you know, what a leader he was, and always, you know, took things and got them done. "Okay, George, you and Jay are gonna stand over here and hold me by my arms, dip me over the side of the wall. Dick, what I want you to do is I want you to jump up, shimmy yourself up, and then you and Sally over here try to pull him over the while George was holding us, and we're like, "Okay, it sounds great, Tony, it sounds great, let's do it." So we hold him over the wall, and Big Hoy jumps up, and grabs onto his legs, and climbing his way up, oh, and just about when he gets to his waist, he slips a little bit, grabs Tony's belt, and whew, his pants went right down to his ankles. And I must say, he was commando. And as the commando was yelling, "Get me up, get me up!" Jay Joseph and I looked at each other and went, "What'd he say?" And all the older women who were over there, of course, were hiding their eyes, but their fingers were just like this. I think they could see a little bit. So those are the type of adventures that Tony and I went on. And the last thing I'm going to tell you, this is very quick, is that we hosted the SoccerPlus goalkeeping school. Some of the people who were associated with here at Bates College, where I coached for 3 years. And so, you know, I had ruined all of Tony's stuff. And he had just gotten back, I think, from the World Cup with you, Anson. He was talking about runes and all this other stuff. Remember that? I don't know. But anyway, he saved the day by making sure that he studied all the penalties, all the goalkeepers. He gets back, and so he's running the camp, and it's going, "Wow, we're having a great time," and we're getting the end of the session. "So let me give you a ride back to the dorm." So we're walking back in the car, and His son, Drew, who just spoke, Drew, I was just a little tyke. I don't know how old you were, Drew, at that point, but not too big. But he had picked up a rock, and he's walking along, and he says, "Where's the car?" And I said, "Oh, it's right over here." And Drew goes, breaks the windshield in the back of my truck, in my van or whatever it was, and Tony looks at me and goes, "Now we're even." That's my redemption right there. So, yeah, as I've always said, you know, Tony is such a special person and such a wonderful friend, you know, and the whole family and Diane. Many times I come down and recruit and stay with them, and just the love you felt from Tony. I'm feeling it now. I really am, Drew. I'm feeling it right here. But I know he's up there and he's smiling over us. And he was just one of the best people I knew. I'm going to leave it at that. Let somebody else come up and have a little chat. So thank you very much.
Our souls are not hungry for fame, comfort, wealth, or power. Our souls are hungry for meaning, for the sense that we have figured out how to live, that our lives matter. So that the world will be at least a little bit different from our having passed through it. There is no greater proof of Tony DiCicco living this Harold Kushner quote and the people in this room that are here to celebrate his life. Because in watching his extraordinary example, we were all touched and inspired to live in a certain way so that our lives mattered as well. Anthony and Drew asked me to take you back to the late 80s, the grand adventure of the development of our sport on an international level. Please understand the time and circumstances when Tony, Lauren, Greg, and I were hired. Right now, looking back, it's absolutely unrecognizable. It was in 1986 when we were given the reins, and the United States had never won a game in international competition. Not only were we not respected as a soccer-playing nation, but we were very inexperienced as well. Between August of 1987 and the 1991 World Championship in China, the national team played 43 games outside the United States and only 7 games at home. Many of the younger players, particularly Christine Lilly, suffered acute homesickness. Yes, that same Christine that went on to set an international caps record, that will never be touched. So our idea as a staff was to find as many hostile environments as we could to harden our team. The team traveled to Italy on a cargo plane and then practiced on a field composed primarily of gravel. We rode 17 hours through China on a coal train, arriving at our destination with soot covering our faces, and then stayed in a hotel so grimy that we slept with our clothes on. We often traveled to games on rickety old school buses, sometimes accompanied by the team we were about to play. There weren't many perks back then. We wore hideous pink and green sweatsuits and uniforms handed down from the men's national team, many of which were so threadbare that the shorts had splits in the back. The players were not paid, attendance was paltry, and media attention was virtually non-existent. For obvious reasons, the players were skeptical whenever Tony, Lauren, and I waxed poetic about a Women's World Cup or participation in the Olympics. We kept selling the dream. Ironically, the country the players hated most was China. Not the Chinese team, mind you, the country. And damned if that wasn't the place FIFA tried to hide the first Women's World Championship in case it failed. In Guangzhou, there is a saying that they eat everything with four legs except the table. The players were served dog, ox, and cat, which meant they mostly ate Snickers, available in bulk because the candy company was an event sponsor for that first Women's World Championship. For all of us, Tony was fantastic from the beginning. He pretended he loved the food, so he ate everything that he was served. Lauren and I were also convinced that if it would have helped morale, Tony also would have eaten the table. Speaking of morale, everything was fun with Tony. I loved watching Michelle Akers get to her potential. You would see her working on her strike before practice. You would see her working on her strike after practice. You would see her working on her strike during practice. And the great fear Tony had is the goalkeepers we had would be so injured by the time a major event rolled around, he jumped into goal all the time to protect the goalkeepers from Michelle. I used to see these contests they would play. I would hear Tony in the background, "All right, Mish, here's the game. 10 shots outside the 18, the ball has to be rolling, and I will stop you, and you won't score more than 4 in this." And all of a sudden, of course, Michelle's burying them in the back of the net. I turn around now. The penalty, of course, has been, Tony's now bent over in the goal, and Michelle is now, of course, shooting at him. We have a fantastic video, because Michelle has a very accurate shot. And when she smacks it, it is moving very rapidly. So I turned around to catch this, and sure enough, Michelle caught him square. And with perfect comic timing, he wobbled a bit, and then he fell over. I promise you, we will show that to you one day. It's actually been captured on video. Our favorite person to tease was Amanda Cromwell. Of course, you only tease the people you love, and our best prank, it was unbelievable. Lauren got a wonderful video from Amanda's father. Tony made it seem like we're just gonna do some, review of, either practice, the upcoming opponent, or, a past game or something, and the whole room was in there ready for this video. And all of a sudden, Lauren hit play, and there is Amanda in full makeup at her cotillion. I didn't know Amanda owned a dress. You should have seen the dress that she was in. Immediately, she recognizes the video and she starts to fight through the crowd to smash the television set to make sure none of us could see this. We watched the whole thing. Periodically, you would hear this bell go off, it'd be a little ding. You would see Amanda do a little bit of a pirouette. You would see her genuflect to her partner, who looked like he was dressed, by the way, in a Confederate uniform. just to set the right, you know, climate for what a cotillion really is. And it was, we were all laughing so hard, I swear, several of us almost died. And of course, that's not the only time we had fun with Amanda. Some of these camps were just extended and we had to figure out ways to have fun. Tony and I used to figure out ways to play 2v2 against anyone, so we decided, you know what? We brought in a goalkeeper that was a D1 scholarship basketball player, and she was massive. She was as big as a mountain. Her name was Jen Mead. Well, Amanda thought she was pretty good in basketball, too. So Tony and I were going to take on Amanda and Jen. Now, Tony can actually play basketball, not much. So Tony had to guard, basically, Jen, the mountain woman. I had to guard Amanda. Now, any of you that have played Amanda in soccer know it's not a very pleasant experience. Well, let me tell you, it's not just her legs that can knock the absolute snot out of you. It's also her upper body. So, after the victory, Tony and I declared that this victory was greater and more unlikely than our world championship run. I consider it one of my great athletic achievements in my life. Let me say, I love having this public forum because I want to thank publicly Mia. Mia was my touchstone, and for so many of us, she was to help us navigate this horrible tragedy in our lives, and I appreciate her for it. She navigated Tony's wonderful family, kept us in the loop, shared with us what would be best for Tony and everyone. Mia, thank you. You've done this for me on so many occasions, and this was another one. I want to thank Anthony and Drew, who called me just in time. My plan, a camp was finishing up. It was Saturday, the camp ended at noon on Sunday. I was going to go into work on Monday. I was going to clear my desk, and I was going to write the most heartfelt note to Tony. I was going to edit it about 17 to 20 times and make sure it was absolutely perfect. And Anthony said, no, Anson, text him something right now. Thank you, boys. For letting me say goodbye to my wonderful friend. And here's what I texted. Dearest Tony, in 1986, you and I and Lauren were asked to take the U.S. women's national team. At the time, the United States had never won a game in international competition. 5 years later, we were the first women's world champions. 5 years after that, you reshaped our team and became the world's first women's Olympic gold medalists. 3 years later, after polishing the team a bit more in front of 90,000 people in the Rose Bowl, you led our country to our second world championship. You also raised the bar, not just for women's soccer on the planet, but for women's athletics. I'm bringing all this up just to confirm your place in the firmament of the great people who have changed the world for the better. But those achievements are not why I love you. They're not why all of your players love you, and your resume is certainly not why your wonderful wife and extraordinary children love you, Tony. You are one of the kindest, most loyal, most principle-centered men I have ever known. I can't believe the luck that brought us together. Bob Ganser, my national team coaching mentor, said, you were the missing staff member for me. I trusted Bob completely, and he was right. The fun we had together for 8 years, picking our team, shaping our team, traveling all over the world, teaming up against our managers during any extended stop, and crushing them in any 2v2 sport competition we could design. And every day my respect and trust and love for you grew. You were great where I was horrible. Your attention for detail was extraordinary. Your willingness to watch tape until your eyes were bloodshot verged on masochism. There was nothing you would not do for me or our cause. And more importantly, I knew if I left, not only was the coaching box checked for our women's national team, but the care for their personal and individual humanity was protected as well. Please allow me to say thank you, Tony, for the Mount Rushmore achievements and service to our game and our country. But more importantly, deep appreciation from me for going all in when no one cared about our game. When you step back, there is going to be a terrifying silence in our country's leadership voice and an empty hole in the middle of my heart. You are easily one of the finest men I know.
Ears. One other prank I must mention. Brandy was always easy fodder, right? Tony and I, one time, Brandy had just gotten married, and it was her first year anniversary, and we had a game, of course. And back in those days, we used to have a sponsor event after the game, so now you can bolt out of town and get home after games. But then you had to stay for the sponsored event, and you couldn't leave till the next day. And so Brandy really wanted to get home for her anniversary. So Tony and I came up with a plan where Hank Steingrescher, who was then the Secretary General of U.S. Soccer, the head of U.S. Soccer, put on his letterhead that, Brandy, we've received your request, and we can't believe that your loyalty lies with your family over the team. And your request essentially has been denied, and we thought that you were more loyal than that. So we know when the envelope is getting handed to Brandy and we're boarding the bus, and they hand the envelope on official U.S. soccer letterhead to Brandy. She comes, literally, she sits down in her seat on the bus. There's like steam coming out of her ears, lava flowing out of them. And she comes stomping back to me, sits down next to me. Read this. Can you believe this? And I was like, that is not right. That is so wrong. You need to go talk to Tony about that. Well, Tony, of course, is in on it, right? So she stomps up the bus, sit next to Tony, and is back and forth with him, back and forth, back and forth, and I let it go for a good 5 minutes, 10 minutes. We finally, I come up there, I sit next to Tony, and we're like, this is unbelievable. And then we look at her, and we're like, or maybe you just got pumped. She's like, what? Tony's career happened with the first women's pro league coming to the United States. That was the WUSA. Tony, of course, was the first commissioner of that league. And then as well, in the second iteration, we're now on our third, but in the second iteration of the women's pro league, Boston Breakers GM and president, Joe Cummings, had the masterful stroke of getting Tony to come back to coaching, and he coached the Boston Breakers for that 2009 to 2011 WPS stint. And as we mentioned before, there are a lot of Boston Breakers players in the house as well. But I would like to introduce the great Joe Cummings.
Thank you to the DiCicco family. I'm honored to offer brief remarks at this celebration of life. I wish to spend a moment talking about Tony the man, for that is what I shall remember the most. You see, when you hire a coach, you hire someone that you will spend a lot of time with. It would have been silly of me to talk to Tony about his soccer decisions, for clearly he was one of the finest coaches our sport has produced. I hired him not because he was someone that I knew would do the job, but someone I wanted to spend time with. Tony and I would be in the office together early in the morning or late in the evening, and our conversations were about family, about getting older, about being married, about who we were as individuals, as people. Anthony, Drew, Alex, and Nick, I know all about you. And you may not even realize this. Tony and I would talk about having sons. We would discuss our dreams for them, their teenage years, the laughter and joy of being a parent. Diane, Tony, and I would discuss what it meant to be a father and a husband, the early years of marriage, and how much they meant to us. And frequently, we would both agree how blessed we were to have found such friends in the women we were married to. You see, we didn't talk about soccer. We talked about so much more. After every game that Tony coached the Boston Breakers, he would send to the entire staff a recap email of what the team did well, what they needed to improve on, updates for the week. At the end of each email, Tony would close with words such as, "I love coaching this team," or "It is an honor to work with you every day." Little did he know that he was coaching us all, or that it was an honor for us to have him as our coach. It is said that a dictionary gives words a definition, but not meaning. There are those who would say we have acquaintances, and there are those that we say are our friends. For me and all of you here today, Tony was a friend. Acts of friendship result in improvement, better attitudes, self-reliance, comfort, consolation, self-respect, and better welfare. Tony gave all of us that. There was a bond with him. Tony had the ability to make us feel as if we were his friend, for he left us improved daily by his willingness to love, encourage, and guide according to our needs. We would all answer the same when asked, "Did your time with Tony DiCicco make you a better person?" Our answer would be a resounding yes. And the beauty of that response is that we shall carry forth his friendship to those we meet in the future in his name. Such an enduring legacy. Is there a greater gift than that which you receive in life, and yes, even in death? Tony, I pray that our friendship, I returned in equal measure what you gave to me. In closing, I borrow words from Dorothy Mumford Williams of Adelphi University. For me, they captured the man, Tony DiCicco, and his time with all he meant. To those whom my life may touch in slight measure, may I give graciously of what is mine. No words better capture this man who gave us graciously so much. Mertz, and Amanda Cromwell.
It's on? Yeah, it's on. This is an amazing day. As I told Anthony earlier this week, there's a moment I was dreading and anticipating and excited for all at the same time. And it's so great to see teammates. That sisterhood is strong. Anson, as always, I love you. Lauren Gregg, my college coach as well, his national team. But I just publicly wanted to say something to Diane, because I think so much in all of this, it's kind of forgotten how the woman she was all of these years was so great for us to see as national team players. I really respected your strength, your confidence, the aura you put out there for us women on a daily basis, whether we were in training camp, traveling, whatever it was. Diane, I respect you so much, and I just have such a warm place in my heart for you. And I just wanted to say that, just make sure you knew that. There's so many stories we could talk about, going back as a player in the U20s, and it's interesting, because I had picked out that 2v2 basketball story as well. And I'd be remiss not to add to that, Anson, as I'm the 5'7 point guard, and Anson picks on me, and meanwhile Tony has to battle what I called her a wall. Jen Mead, the 6-foot wall. But Anson would back me in, and for those of you that are older, maybe know who Adrian Dantley was. He kept on saying, I'm Adrian Dantley, and I was like, who is that? I don't know who that is. And meanwhile, he's throwing elbows. I remember leaving one time with a fat lip, and I just imagined how bruised up Tony was after battling Jed Mead. But the thing about Tony, he was so ultra competitive at everything, whether it was 2v2 basketball, the small-sided games we played as the reserve players and the staff. It was awesome. And I think, are the slides going to go? We have slides during our U20 time. Hopefully, they'll get those up there. You can see him, he has a wrestling match with one of our massage therapists, Nestor. They're literally wrestling each other while we're playing small-sided soccer. The really cool thing for me is I got to experience Tony not only as a player, but also as an assistant coach. And I saw just what kind of care and value and love he gave to all of the players. And for me personally, one of those times that really hit home that I've never shared with anyone in the family, or really anyone in my family. I tore my ACL in 96 in February. That was about, I think, 4 or 5 months before the Olympics. And that was pretty devastating. That was one thing as a kid. In my high school yearbook, I put, future plans was, I think I'll only put go to the Olympics. And at the time, women's soccer wasn't even in the Olympics. And I had such, that was just the Olympics growing up for me. It was just such this awesome, iconic event. And, tearing my ACL, obviously I was very devastated. My mom was in town, and I got the MRI right away. And there's two phone calls that were really meaningful to me. One was Michelle Akers, my best friend on the team, but Tony was the other one. And as a player that was fighting for a position on that team, and at the time it was only a roster of 16, it could have been easy, like, tough luck, Sal, come back for next year. And, he could have tried to appease me. But what Tony said to me was beyond belief, because, 5 months before the Olympics, this is 96, mind you, when ACLs weren't like they were today with the rehab process. And Tony said to me, I remember as clear as day, is, Sal, if you can get back, we'll save your spot in camp. And we'll give you a chance. And lo and behold, he set the tone for my rehab. I got back in 3 months, got back down in camp in May. Didn't have enough time, I think, and I think it would have been a little bit risky for a coach to pick a player in the roster of 16 that just came off ACL, but it chose me for that roster of 20 as an alternate. And Tony breathed vision into my life, and I think that's what he did for so many. And that's what I saw him do with those U20s. a lot of those players were trying to find their way. Oh, there's the wrestling match. There it is. We knew that was gonna get some laughs. A lot of those U20s were trying to find their way, and just like he did for me as a player, I saw him do it again and again with those U20s. Is not only did he believe in them, but he gave them permission to believe in themselves. And as a coach now in college at UCLA, that's probably the biggest gift he gave to me as a coach and as a mentor in my life, is that I truly know how to value each and every member of my team, no matter what their status is as a player. And that's something I thank Tony so much for, is that gift he passed on to me, and I think all the rest of us.
Thank you, Amanda. 3 months recovery, that's, you don't see that very much these days. My journey with Tony started in 93. I was a SoccerPlus camper at Bates College, and I remember I was a goalkeeper, and my high school coach, Kim Maslin, Kamendider, told me, go to camp. And so I went to this crazy camp. I didn't know what I was getting myself into, and there's people flying all over the place. They're pressure training and loving it. You got people dressed up in crazy goalkeeper jerseys. And it was awesome. It was the best thing I'd ever experienced. I felt this sense of belonging. The staff was energetic, they were positive, they were fun, they were crazy as all get out. And I wanted to be like them. And, I walked away from Bates College with two things. One, a sense of belonging, a sense of, here's my home, these are my people. You guys know us goalkeepers are a little bit quirky and crazy. And I felt that I wanted to be like that staff. And so after that, I worked for SoccerPlus for over 9 years and was fortunate to have the best summers of my life. And Tony created this environment for us as a staff where all the summers we figured out who we were as young adults. We were taught how to love and give back to the game. The passion that he instilled in us as a staff member to teach the young kids is something that, was a gift to us as a staff member. And then I was fortunate enough to work with these crazy fools and be a part of the U20 World Cup staff. And I got to mentor under the legend himself and how to teach and coach Alyssa Nair, Chantel Jones, Kat Parkhill. But I think I learned a lot about video, because these two, they didn't do much about video. And there are times that late at night, we're up doing video, Tony and I were. Not sure where Amanda was, maybe down at the bar, but a little bit of a roast for Amanda. But most importantly, he taught those players, a sense of belonging. We figured out, watched Nikki Washington's career, Alex Morgan, Sydney LaRue, watched them grow into these young adults. And that was similar to what he did with SoccerPlus camps, is he gave you a forum to believe in yourself and really be who you are and accepted of who you are. So I thank him for that. And one thing that I like to quote is, the future belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. And we all know, Tony always says, dream big, play hard, play to win, but also have fun. I mean, those are the most important things that I think I've taken away from Tony. So thank you to DiCicco family for sharing the love.
So here's one of the coolest things that's happening here today so far, is that when we got to work with Tony and we got our slice of DiCiccoville, we thought, okay, we're getting this guy at this point of his career, it's exciting. We hadn't won the U20 World Cup in two previous tries. They're bringing in the heavy hitter. We're certainly lucky to be here, but what's this gonna be like? I mean, he's been at the top. And what I'm hearing from everybody, from his college roommate to Joe, to Julie, to everyone, is we got all what you guys got. We got the full-on Tony. And for anyone who ever suspected that he ever took his foot off the gas for 1 second, I see Nikki nodding her head, we got the full-on DiCicco experience. And now it's verified, because I was just thinking, my gosh, this guy was amazing. And now I'm hearing, not only I knew he was amazing before, but we got everything he had. And And this is a real tribute to who he was. You know, Kat, I'm just going to tell you that he told me that you were like a daughter to him. And when he put this staff together, he inherited me kind of, and I had to reprove myself, and he picked these guys. He told me that Kat was like a daughter to him after we won the world championship, and interestingly enough said, you know, maybe another time, another place, Thom, maybe you and Kat. And I was like, I don't think so. I don't think she looks at me like that. But, which I'm just announcing that now for the first time. I'll put that on Twitter. And with Amanda, he said to me, he goes, you know, Thom, here's the thing I want our 20s to know. I want them to know about resiliency. I cut Amanda 4 times. She came back 5 times. Said we'd have camp in Florida and she would just show up with her cleats and be like, Tony, I know you need numbers. And she'd have somehow already got her training gear and she'd be back, you know, in camp. So we were really fortunate, you know, to have this group. I think in my case, Jill Ellis had taken the 20s and had hired me to be her assistant for this U20 World Cup run. We were just putting this thing together. It was my first opportunity to represent the U.S. in that capacity. I'm at the hotel. We've never even had a practice. Jill calls me to her room and says, okay, by the way, good news and bad news. The good news is Pia just asked me to be her full-time assistant. And the bad news is the new coach is going to want to hire their own staff. I said, Jill, I've been on the job for 5 minutes. And you're probably the only coach that would have hired me, so I'm in real trouble here. And I said, well, who's going to be the new head coach? He said, Tony DiCicco. And as we all do, we kind of go into, I'd really like to keep this job survival mode. I'm replaying every awful conversation that I had with Tony when he was the commissioner and I was the young, feisty WSA coach, and they weren't always great. And I'm like, at some point during those 4 years, I have destroyed any chance of this going my way. So you would think a guy like Tony would come in, and of course, you know, he's on the hotline with Lauren and Jay and all of his loyal, you know, advisors, and he's thinking about what he's going to do, and he walks in, and he's like, okay, here's the thing. I know Jill just brought you on, and this is who Tony was, right? He said, so tell me why you want the job. I'm like, all right, number one, I want to learn from you. You're the most successful international coach in the history of the women's game. You know the ins and outs of coaching internationally, and I'm fascinated by the idea of training a team that really isn't your team massive parts of the year. How do you come in and out of camp and become a great team and win a world championship when you have to give them back all the time? Like, that whole process just fascinated me. And I'll never forget, he was tying his shoes, we're in our room, and he looks up at me and goes, okay, you got the job for now. I was like, okay, so I'm going to stick through this practice. And he says, let's just see how the whole thing works itself out. And at the time, I just went right over my head. But those of you who have been DiCicco'd, those of you who are part of the DiCicco method, know exactly what that meant. There's so much more than X's and O's, and can I help coach, or was Kat a great goalkeeper coach, or was Amanda going to add, you know, 50 extra people to every game because of the posse that followed her around. Like, it was so much more, and he was going to wait and see how it came together. And whether we, myself, or the staff could be a part of his methodology, his way. So he said, we'll see how it all works out. I missed that at the time, now it's so evidently clear. So we get going, we get to the World Cup, and we take a van ride, coal getting in our skin, but we're in a van ride in which we almost perished several times. The van guy just honked and weaved and bobbed. We went to the jungle of Chile. We go to watch the opening game, and it's Brazil, and it's North Korea, and they're playing, and it looks like I'm watching two pro teams. I'm like, these guys are like our full national team. And I look at Tony 40 minutes into the game, I go, in all fairness, coach, if this is the level that's going to be at the top of this World Cup, what are we going to do with our college girls? How are we going to compete with our college girls against these two teams? They looked ridiculous. They are now the current Brazilian team, pretty much was that team. And he goes, Thom, the final is not for 34 days. We are going to get so much better, and we are going to get so much closer. Now, of course, young soccer guy, all I hear is we're going to get so much better. And I miss what it is that is the magic of this man as a person, as a leader, as a mentor, which was, we're going to get so much closer. Because what he knew all along, and why I love that Julie mentioned how happy he would be about the president of this university being a female, is that Tony loves and loved the female mentality. He absolutely was the biggest proponent of what badass is all you are, and he absolutely was obsessed with that. And also, to Amanda's point, letting you feel that. So we go through the World Cup, I'll spare you all those details, and we get to towards the end, we're winning games, and we have Germany, who's the number one probably team at the tournament, in the semifinals. And this is when a year and a half of a guy who literally thinks of everything. He leaves no stone unturned, he thinks of everything. You talk about teaching us as coaches, everything. This guy fought for the equipment manager that we wanted. It had to be Beto. the doctor that we wanted, it had to be the guy that spoke four languages who all the girls adored. For the security guy that we wanted, because he was the personality Tony wanted around our team, and he's getting emails back from the Fed like, yeah, we'll let you know who your security guy is. He's like, no, this is our guy. I saw 50 emails, Anthony, fighting for roller bags. Because our girls are gonna have to haul across Chile for 30 days with 100-pound bags. They pack a lot when you expect to go to the final over 30 days. And he's fighting for roller bags. No, another email. Not in our budget, another email. Can't do it, another email. Pretty soon Nike shows up with 50 giant roller bags. The guy left those stone unturned. So we're about to play Germany. We walk in, our meeting's about 30 or 40 minutes, you know, from Cats Film. Then she clipped while Amanda was who knows where, and Tony and I were jogging somewhere or doing something. And the meeting lasted about 5 minutes. And he said, guys, let's go down to the pool. Let's hang out. Let's relax. And I thought, he thinks we're ready. And the gift he's giving to girls in that moment is this empowerment of, you're ready. We go down to the side of the pool. The fire is raging. Keela Winters gets her guitar out. She starts playing music. We start singing. Now the Germans are in the same hotel, right across the pool from us. They're looking at us, we're looking at them. The cafeterias were split down the middle. They're eating here, we're eating here. And they all close their blinds and start like eating nails and doing push-ups and doing German things. And they're like angry. Look at the Americans having fun. What in the world is going on here? We have the biggest game of our lives tomorrow. And Tony's just like beaming. And we're down there for 2 hours. We're not talking soccer. You know what we're doing? We're not getting better. We're getting closer. Because we're getting closer, we're getting better. And it started to sink in, this guy is so much more than a soccer coach. This guy is so much more than a genius of who we should pick. And even though we cut out his worry, we were smart enough to bring it back. And so it started to dawn on me, and Anthony was there that day by the fire, we walked off, and he goes, what do you think? And I looked at Anthony, and I go, there's absolutely no chance of us losing more. All of a sudden, through a campfire, we're a better team. This was Tony. This is Tony at his absolute best. This is Tony, the family man, the mentor, the coach, the whole thing. So, of course, the next day we win. Tony made a major strategic decision to do something the Germans had never happened to them. They were like top of the world in possession. He paid his own money to get a heat map of their passing patterns throughout the World Cup with the company, because when we sent the email came back, don't have it in the budget. So Tony paid for it himself to get a heat map of their passing patterns. We shut off the side that they love to go down, et cetera, et cetera. His X's and O's were unquestionable. We beat Germany, we beat North Korea in the final, and we are world champions. Tony just gave us the best lessons of our lives, and so few of them were about soccer. And I realized when he said, you want this job, and asked me why, and I told him, that's when he began the process of mentoring. I didn't ask to be mentored. At that age, I thought I knew more than I for sure did. And I didn't need to be mentored, even though he was the greatest coach in this sport in the world. But he started the mentoring process. And I said, Tony, I'll just pick up cones for all the way to the World Cup final if that's all you want. I just want to be a part of this. So for 2 months, he took me up on that. Picked up cones, I put down cones. He said, if I look at you, you talk. If I don't say anything. You know why? Because he knew I needed to be humble. I didn't ask for that. He was right. I thought I knew too much. And he didn't point the finger. This isn't a guy who used the word culture. Tony just was culture. And in that process, I mean, I don't know how you fall in love with a guy, but I did. It was unbelievable the impact that he had on us. And the hardest part about all this is how many times each one of us think to ourselves, oh, I gotta text Tony that. Oh, I gotta call Tony. And we have this great texting thing when he does TV. And one time I was a little bit late getting my thoughts after his halftime, and he's writing me from somewhere on the other side of the world. My gosh, that took you forever. Like, are you kidding me? And I'm gonna miss that. I'm gonna miss that part of it like no other. And I will tell you to the family, and Diane, when we had dinner on that World Cup run, I said, there we go. Behind every great man is a great woman. That's proof in the pudding. Getting to know the brothers and Anthony especially. What you did, Anthony, to reach out to some of us and say, write my dad now, was the most selfless thing that a family member could ever do. You should have been thinking about yourself. You should have been thinking about your dad. You know, you thought about other people. And I told you that previously, and I want to echo that now. That was a very, very Tony type of thing. And we all hear about legacies, and we all hear about lasting impact when famous people die. The lasting impact of Tony on soccer, for sure. But the lasting impact on all of us as people, that's the one that won't fade till we're all gone. So to the DiCicco family, we love you guys. And through him, through you, Tony lives on. stronger than ever.
Next, we'll hear from Nikki Washington. Prior to launching her professional soccer career, Nikki Washington captained Tony's USA squad that won the 2008 U20 Women's World Cup. Ladies and gentlemen, Nikki Washington.
Over the past couple weeks, I've been a lot reminiscing about the time I spent with Tony. I was fortunate enough to play for Tony on multiple teams, but most notably in the U20 World Cup in 2008 with those guys. I think most people would expect me to continue the speech by detailing the close games, the hard practices, and team conflicts we endured, and how it all culminated with us hoisting a trophy over our heads, announcing us world champions. Yeah, that was fun, and winning never hurt anyone. Unless, of course, you're the 99 China team, watching Brittany Chastain shred her clothes and your dreams simultaneously. But as I look back a decade later, the wins and trophies and celebrations actually are not what has stuck with me the most, nor what has had a profound impact on my everyday life. Another common theme. What Tony gave me and so many others were core values and lessons on how to live. These three are the ones that have affected me the most. Simplicity, joy, and family. Simplicity. Tony lived and led with simplicity. He showed us that life is about having a resolve to be your best self while loving others around you. Simple. That's it. Have a resolve to be your best self and to love others. And like with many other things in life, simplicity is beautiful because it chooses a few things over everything. And Tony lived this out to a T. He never stopped working to improve his craft. I'm talking about golf, of course. And he never compromised on loving others. Joy. Tony loved the game. Julie, you mentioned this story already once, but one of my favorite on-field memories is Tony walking around after we cooled down, and he's always observing things and walking around. But he would say, "I love my job." And for someone as young as us in our group to see someone be that passionate had such a profound impact on us. There's always just such a joy that exuded from Tony. And the love of the game is what bound us together. And in fact, I'm convinced that this is the greatest vehicle for connecting humans to one another. The joy Tony possessed traveled through soccer and landed directly on hearts. It went beyond the game and infiltrated the lives of those he encountered, and that's why we're all gathered here today. Family. Throughout our two-year cycle competing in the World Cup, that was the first time I was introduced to Tony's family. He would frequently talk about his boys, and we even got to spend some time on the road with them. Drew would jump in on a practice, inevitably making us look like US YSA players. Anthony would travel with us, providing tips, helping the team understand Dad a little more. And of course, the team favorite was when Diane would come on a trip. We were always so intrigued and oddly satisfied to see that our fearless leader had a weak spot. Seriously, we loved it because when Diane was around, for the first time we saw Tony second in charge. Watching them interact was like finally understanding the inner workings of a clock. 2 years ago, Tony was inducted into the NSCA Hall of Fame and gave one of my favorite speeches I've ever heard. He explained all the ways in which his family was the best team he'd ever been a part of. Anyone who knows Tony and the DiCiccos knows the truth of that statement. Family wasn't a commodity Tony had, it was a value he lived. I could stand up here for hours naming ways Tony has impacted me and hundreds of others, but our fourth official, Anthony DiCicco, just gave me 2 minutes of soccer time. So instead, I'll just name a few from my U20 teammates. Tony, you inspired me as a player and person throughout our journey. You were an incredible coach that understood every aspect of a team. You were the model of a true leader. We love you. Alyssa Mott's Chicago Red Star support. Tony's joy and passion for the game was magnetic, and I'm so grateful that he was a part of my life on and off the field. I will miss you very much. Ellie Reed, Seattle Rain. When Tony entered the team room for the first time with the U20s, I was intimidated. But once he began to address our young group, I was inspired. He had a way of bringing out the best in people and motivating an entire group. His example of integrity in his everyday life was obvious. Tony, you have set the example for how I want to coach a team someday. Thank you for your influence, integrity, and compassion. You will be missed. Becky Edwards is currently playing professionally in Sweden. So, as you can see, Tony used the most beautiful game as a vehicle to help humans connect to one another. And more than ever, I'm convinced that this is the point of life, connection and love. I am forever changed, like many people here, for having known Tony and sharing some life with him. Tony, your journey was unlike any other. It was perfectly yours and an incredible ride. We love you and we'll always, always miss you.
Mick D'Arcy, Skye, Eddy, Bruce, and Dave Latourette. Please come to the stage.
I'm going to try to be a little bit of a Dave Letterman here and ask these characters some questions to kind of help us navigate through this, but we'll get right to it and start with Dave Latourette. And Dave, really quick, as an early SoccerPlus goalkeeper school director in the 80s and 90s, tell us what it was like to work with Tony at camp that made SoccerPlus so special.
You said characters, I think that's Cap Mertz is referring to us as characters, because I think we were at that camp, right? So anyway, so working with Tony was, I didn't really know much about Tony when I first got brought into camp. I had someone say, hey, I'm a senior in college, see if you can get in and work with Tony and enter some educational background where I wanted to go as a coach, as a person. And then the evolution started. But when we talk about Tony, and I think a lot of it, we had a discussion the other day via Skype, although Mick was on his 1987 Motorola phone from Dublin. I kept throwing just words out. I think everyone has encompassed that. George and Anson and Kat, Drew, everybody has used all the words and probably say the same things. But one of the things for me that I always felt, whether it was on the field, whether it was working at a clinic with him, whether it was gracious enough to give his time to me, to teach me, was his presence. He had a massive presence. I wrote big, but he had a massive presence. And considering he was the smallest goalkeeper to ever put on a national team jersey, male or female, he had a huge presence. And that was one of the biggest things. And he brought a professionalism to goalkeeping, to the camps, that was immediate. It wasn't asked of, it was just you followed suit. And from pulling your socks up, making sure you wear your long sleeve jersey on the right day of training. We had a laugh about Saskia Weber realizes that you don't wear the short sleeve goalkeeper jersey on the day you're doing forward smother dives in the gravel pit. Saskia learned that lesson really, really quick. And the biggest thing is that there was a 100% learning environment with him. Whether you realize it or not, it was a 100% learning environment. And he always had a belief in us. And I say us here, and us being a lot of you that are out there as well, that, whether he said it or not, and I remember early on with him, I was working in a store. I would come in the morning, do what he needed to do, go off to Eastern Connecticut, coach, and I would run this little cycle. And every day, I remember coming to, he had just been pulled into the under 20 men's national team at the time. Pulls me into his office, hits the intercom button, and I'm downstairs doing something, walk up the rickety stairs of the haunted house in Wethersfield. And he goes, very matter of fact, Tony Way, hey Lotto, I'm going in to work with the under 20 nationals. I need you to go to a clinic in Chicago for me. And I looked at him a little bit, I'm 23, I'm still pretty green. And he goes, it was an AYSO National Coaches Convention. I looked at him, he goes, you'll be fine, don't worry. Just do your job, just remember you're coaching coaches. And I turned around and I walked out, and I kind of glanced back at him, and he just gave me the Tony nod that it's gonna be okay. And that was enough for me to know that he believed in me and that he was empowering me to go do that.
Moving right along. Scott, you were one of the first female SoccerPlus goalkeeper school directors. And Tony obviously being probably most remembered as the coach for our women's national team. What was it like to be a female at SoccerPlus?
Well, my first week working was actually that week that Pat was talking about, in 1993 up in Bates. And you know, if we go back to where women's sports was in 1993, you know, things are drastically different now. When I arrived to camp, it was so refreshing for me. It was the first time ever where I wasn't the only female staff at a camp. And not only did I have coaching peers for me, but I was able to actually look at the generation before me, to people that were working the camps, to Kim Wyant, to Carla Chin, to Mary Harvey, Kim Aslan. There's some great people that sort of were the generation ahead of me so that I could emulate them as well. And, you know, when we're working SoccerPlus, as Kat mentioned, I wasn't judged ever by my gender. I was judged by my qualifications. I was judged by my competencies. I was judged by my character. And I wasn't always given the youngest girls' group. I was given older boys' groups. I was given opportunities to direct camps where I was overseeing men and women, where I was working and teaching boys and girls as their leader. And there's a few things that came of the SoccerPlus camps and women that we all needed to just take a moment and recognize. The sheer number of female coaches that Tony developed, that came through his camps and that were inspired to a career in soccer or to a career in coaching or to better themselves. And the second thing that I think is really important to think about is the fact that from his camps left a generation of men who were totally fine working alongside women and totally embraced and saw the power of working alongside women. And I think my favorite part of being a woman at the camps was maybe Monday mornings when they broke up into groups and they list the groups, and I had this group of 17, 16-year-old boys walking over to me. And they'd be kind of side looking at themselves, and you know they're thinking, a girl? And I'd love to be able to teach them in that week just how powerful a girl
can be. She also realized that Skye was treated equally, so it doesn't matter if she was male or female. When she was a rookie staff, she was treated like a rookie staff, and if anyone wants to see photos of some of them.
I bet David Letterman mentioned that his own mic, just to let you know. But Skye, you were a staff coach and director when I was just a camper, freshman, sophomore year in high school, and I told you this earlier. Tony certainly had a way of making sure that the women were a huge part of SoccerPlus, and I just remember Skye and her UMass jersey, and she seemed like Wonder Woman to me. An inspiration, fight through any demo. She wouldn't hide at camp, and I think Tony had a way of probably, you know, pulling that out of you every day. So we'll move on to Mick now, and Mick, you had the opportunity to work very closely with Tony in the beginning in the SoccerPlus store. Lucky enough to come and visit us there, certainly at the camps all over the country, and more recently certainly at the club. So what were some of the lessons that you learned from home?
Gosh, we could be here all day. Yeah, so much we've learned from Tony over the years. Kind of had this question has been asked a lot in the last couple of weeks, and there's a couple of words that do come to mind. The first one is humility. And I keep coming back to that one over and over and over, because that was Tony. He seemed to become more humble the more successful he became. It didn't matter where he was coming back from, you know, whether it be the Olympics, whether it be a world championship, whatever. The man was always humble. And we're in a profession that's, let's face it, can be vain at times. We're trying to win, we're all very competitive, and there's rewards that go along with that, but that's not what Tony was about. He always made sure that the focus wasn't on him, and I think that starts with the camps too. It was never Tony to cheap us SoccerPlus camps, or go to the school with SoccerPlus. The next thing I think was loyalty. My relationship with Tony was 25 years, and he was always there for me, and I know he was always there for so many other people. I think if I asked people in the audience, put your hand up if Tony was a reference for a job that you applied for, I mean, most of you probably put your hand up, and most of you got the job too, because of what he was able to do for you. And that's how it was a phone call. And I remember back in the office in Wethersfield, and somebody had approached me and said, "Could you do you think Tony would be a reference for me? Would you write a letter of reference for me?" So I said, "Okay, I'll be the go-between person. I'll ask." And I went up to Tony and said, "So and so needs a letter of reference." He goes, "Nick, I don't write letters of reference." I'm like, "Oh, okay." He goes, "Get me a phone number and I'll call." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "Find out who is on the search committee, or who the AD or whoever it would be, and I'll pick up the phone and I'll call them." And that's pretty good. Now you got someone who just won the World Cup, just won the Olympics, that's prepared to make a phone call for you. And those phone calls went a long way. But the last thing I'll come back to is just having fun. I mean, this is we worked hard at the camps, we worked hard at the store, but I mean, you know, the club, wherever it was always hard work. But he always found a way to have fun and to enjoy himself and to make sure that we enjoyed ourselves too. And it was hard work, and I'm sure I could talk about hard work and what he did, and, you know, going away on these, you know, long trips down to Florida for residency camps and coming back and, I mean, straight back into the office the next day and putting in long hours in there. But he found ways to enjoy himself too. And there was one quick story I just wanted to tell. Back in 94, when we hosted the World Cup here, the Men's World Cup, and there was a lot of work going on. We were doing stuff in the mail order business in the store and going to the camps, and we all felt that we were working really hard. And I decided one day I'm gonna take the afternoon off, and I'm gonna go to the semi-final of the World Cup. And it was Italy against Bulgaria down in Giant Stadium. The folks, I think that's were nice enough to give us tickets. I said, I'm not even gonna tell Tony I'm taking the afternoon off. He's busy at camp, he'll never know. I get into Giant Stadium, walk down, got my seat, look over, there's Tony sitting 2 seats away. He took the afternoon off as well, so.
Mick, it's just to kind of carry over on that a little bit, all the SoccerPlus staff coaches that are out there coaching, whether it's the professional, the college game, so on and so forth, and we touched on it earlier, how it's just the four of us chosen to be up here. But we've been very fortunate to work with some great coaches across the country at SoccerPlus camps, in the club. You can all probably talk about this a little bit, maybe Dave, we'll start with you. Talk a little bit about the SoccerPlus network, if you will.
It's ironic that you asked, because when we talked the other day, I think Nick had mentioned something, and I sent a text out to you all, and I said, you know, talk about Tony's coaching tree, you know, and then I started to laugh a little bit. I said, it's not a tree, it's a forest, because, you know, a tree grows in one direction, and stuff grows out from it. Really, with Tony's tree, leaves blow off, they land somewhere else, they sprout something new, and I think this group here is just a very minute, you know, testament to that. And I look around, and Chris Dukar, Billy Steffen, Bernie Watt, you know, coming in for a quick day. I flew in on a red eye last night from California, and other people doing the same. Kat's coming from Oregon. Amanda's coming from California as well. So to come in and do that, so the tree is out there. And the tree and the forest and everything else that's in between it. And the biggest part of that, and it's, we can talk mentorship because a number of people have said that, and the learning environment and that aspect of it, but it's just an ongoing teaching thing when you brought people together. He wasn't trying to do it. It was just Tony, and it's just what he did. He did it in the store. He did it at the camps. He did it at 11:30 at night in staff meetings when we weren't talking about the camp, or who knows what we were talking about. But he brought people together. And he brought people together so those people could learn from each other. They could mentor each other. And for me, it was Tony, because I got to see Tony a lot, and I was fortunate. You know, and I got to go to the house, and I don't know if Tony slapped together peanut butter and jellies or Di did, but then we played basketball in the backyard. But he brought me together with some of my people within the camp that I'm fond of sitting here, but also Chris Dukar, who's out there, and Billy Steffen and Bernie Watt, and they were, and Matt Clark, who's not here, but those are the guys that I feel, you know, very attached to amongst, you know, everybody else. So it's pretty impressive, that tree. And I'll tell a quick story. Billy brought this up to me as we were exchanging some messages, and I'll leave some of the juicy stuff from the outside out of it. But we were at a camp at Babson, and Tony was off with the national team or doing something. And it was a pretty powerful camp in terms of staff. I'll use the egos. And I say egos in a good way, because we all have to be egos to be good at something. Bernie was there, Billy was there, John Pasquarello was there, Mary Harvey was there, Saskia Weber was there. So in terms of some of the firepower that was in that camp from a coaching standpoint, but from a playing standpoint, I think Saskia and Mary at that time were probably fighting for a position, right? We'd gone through this tournament style game of keeper wars, and we got down to the last two teams, and Mary captained the team, and Saskia captained the other team, so you could see how that might go. And what we did is we marched them out World Cup style and had moved the goals around, had people up in the stands, and we had this really personable trainer named Katie Speth. She backs the black SoccerPlus Astro van up, swings the doors open, and starts playing a Ramones song. And it was just cranking. And the game just started going like crazy. And all of a sudden, he's like, you feel something in the forest changes. And you turn around and Tony walks through the forest. And it really was, it was like bushes. He walks out of the forest, he's got his goalkeeper glove in the back of his shorts. He struts up with the Tony walk, the head goes down a little bit, and you're thinking, oh no, where is this gonna go? And he just walks up, nods his head, and he goes, well, I see, this camp has developed a personality.
Skye, we all know that Tony liked to have fun, certainly at camp, in the store, with the club, but certainly a fierce competitor as well. What's your favorite Tony competitive story?
I think I'd have to go with the camp. We were working out at Nike at an ANTC, and so in addition to having three really physically demanding sessions a day, and a lecture at night where you were working with the kids until 10:30 at night, and then a staff meeting after that where we went from 11 to sometimes well after midnight, Tony put in place these staff games. So after a morning session, we would have some of the most competitive staff games ever. And I quickly learned that I always wanted to be on Tony's team because he hated to lose. And there was a time where we were out at Nike. We were limited with our time because when we were there, we had to take the kids and vans back to the hotel. They didn't have the luxury of walking to a dorm. So we decided, okay, we're playing to five. It was 4-4. I'm in goal for one team. I think that maybe Tracy Noonan or maybe Rifle was in goal for the other team. And we scored on a third corner because we counted corners there. Three corners and it's a goal. So we win. And then all of a sudden, this big discussion breaks out between, it was a goal kick, it wasn't a corner, it was a goal kick, it wasn't a corner. And they're screaming back and forth, and finally Tony just puts his head down, turns around, he's like, fine, just play. And he walks back, and sadly, about 20 seconds later, they scored on me, and we lost the game. And I found myself sort of cowering behind John Cohen, I think, as I was taking off my cleats, and Tony was just pacing back and forth, just so frustrated that he lost. Because I think also we felt like it wasn't fair. But those were some just killer staff games that we had where his true competitiveness came out.
I might. My one quick Tony competitive story, really quick. We have an office facility here locally where we have the opportunity to use some fields. And at times during the summer, we might have, you know, 10 or more people working in the office at one time. So Tony may have us break into a game before work, at lunch, or maybe even after work. And Tony certainly was competitive, but he would always find a way to find a coaching moment and certainly make sure that things would go a little easier for you as it continues. So my quick story is I was on Tony's team. Certainly one of those times I was fortunate to be on Tony's team because you don't get a chance to win. Tony plays a long ball in along the right-hand side. Again, I'm a goalkeeper, not very good with my feet. And it's a ball that's kind of high, and it's going out. But I said, I've got to get to this ball. This is Tony DiCicco serving me a great ball in. So probably fairly ugly. I just throw myself into the air, stick my foot up, it goes in. I'm feeling pretty good about myself. And everyone's kind of celebrating on our team, and certainly Tony runs over and says, Shawn, great play. But he knew that to pull me back in. After we started to run back to the middle of the field, he kind of pulled me over to the side and he said, hey, next time I give you that ball, make it look easy, just head the ball in, will you? So I know we're running out of time, and one last question I wanted to get to, and we'll give this to Mick. You know, Tony certainly lastly with the club locally, what are some of your views and reflections on what Tony was like with the youth club, and maybe what have you used, what you've learned from Tony in your coaching event?
It was a completely different experience working with Tony with the club because he'd you know, he'd come from winning World Cups and Olympics and so forth, and now he was, you know, starting to work with young children. And, certainly had done at the camps, but now was competitive. And it was part of the humility that the fact we saw in Tony too, because you know, now we were a young club starting off, and you know what, I don't think it was 19.1 was his percentage winning for the national team, but it wasn't as good as that with the club because we were a young club and we were, you know, we were taking our leaps along the way. But it didn't make any difference. Tom hit it on that area, we were going with that. Talk about the full on DiCicco. it didn't matter if they were 8, 9, 10, or all the way up to the SoccerPlus Reds that you took to win a national championship. You got the full on DiCicco all the way through it. I see some players who are in the audience here who played them. And Katie Conley, where are you? Can you stand up for a second? I'm going to embarrass the people that I said to Katie. But Katie Conley played with Tony probably for about 8 years all the way through. And this year, she, hold on, stand for a second. She's just been nominated for the NCAA Woman of the Year. So.
Was the 96 and 99 World Cup. And an interesting phase, because 96 Olympics, when Tony was the head coach, was the first time women's soccer had ever been admitted into the Olympics, ever. And it was in the United States, you will recall, in Atlanta. And the 99 World Cup was the first women's World Cup ever in the United States. So tremendous pressure with both of those events to be successful. And as we all know, we came out on top of both events. But I always find it interesting because so much pressure on us as players, yet when you hear everyone talk on this stage, his ability to diffuse that pressure in such a positive way and really make you feel part of the family, I think is one of the great gifts of Tony. And that he was so willing in those two residential periods, Diane and the boys, to open their homes to us for 6 month stretches where Di was cooking for us and having meals all the time, and you really were a part of that family. And I thank you to Mick for the word and the segue for our next speaker. Humility is what you talked about, Tony. One of the most humble, grounded, selfless teammates we've ever had on the national team is also happens to be one of the greatest players to ever play the game. And we are lucky to have had her as a teammate and to have had her as part of the sport. Me, Hamm.
Just want to say a special thank you to Julie, your energy and humor on a day like today. That and for so many other reasons is why we love you. So thank you. to Di and Anthony and Alex, Drew and Nick. Just thank you for sharing your husband with us, for sharing your father with us. And thank you for trusting me today. All right, I can do this. It's game time. You know, several days after Tony's passing, I was sitting with my daughter, Ava, and we were just sharing space and time together. She grabs my hand and asks me, "What made your coach Tony such a great coach? You've heard so many amazing stories today. You know, Tony was courageous. He was innovative. He was inclusive. He was generous. He was hardworking. He was enthusiastic, and he was passionate." I shared all of these thoughts with her. I also told her that Tony never put us in a situation that he didn't think we couldn't handle. Tony challenged us as players, but he never abandoned us. He used words like us and we, and never you or I. Tony pushed us, but never humiliated us. He formulated intense, competitive training sessions that only strengthen our team chemistry and our commitment to one another. Instead of causing division or tension or animosity. Tony's goal was to be a leader, a mentor. He didn't see his role as trying to control us or dominate us. He was able to express strength without arrogance or bravado. But for me, one of Tony's greatest attributes was that he was real. As you all know, Tony was extremely comfortable in his own skin and confident in who he was as a man, but also in who he was not. I remember Tony sharing with us that he didn't believe he was the best motivational speaker, especially in our pregame meetings. That when he tried, it came across as awkward or rehearsed. So what did he do about it? He brought in someone who that was their strength. Do you know how rare this is? Think about it. A coach at the highest level admitting to a skill that is not his strength. I can tell you, as one of his players, this was incredibly liberating and empowering. As an elite athlete, you spend hours, weeks, years working on your skills, strengthening the technical, physical, and tactical parts of your game. And your weaknesses, you work on improving them. Or in my case, if Christine Lilly's flying down the left flank and she serves the ball towards the center of the box, at my head, you pray like hell that Michelle Akers barrels you over and slams it in the back of the net. And in some cases, you pretend those weaknesses don't exist. Not with Tony as your coach. You see, he taught me that there can be strength in vulnerability. To completely grow as a player and as a person, you have to be willing to put yourself out there, warts and all. He didn't want you to worry about failure, but growth. I didn't have to be perfect for Tony, because he was assembling a team who loved each other, who covered for each other, and who picked each other up. He quite simply created an environment where we can be us, where our personalities can be expressed and individuality celebrated. He allowed us to be crazy, silly, emotional, and semi-nude. He was usually in on the joke as well. And I wish we could find that Austin Powers theme video of Brandy. We were valued and trusted. And that trust was extended to the entire staff. Tony was so amazing at bringing members in and expressing their role and importance in our journey. When you were around Tony, he made everyone want to be more invested, to care more, to love more, to express more joy. As Dr. Colleen Hacker so eloquently said in her article about Tony, he made us all the better versions of ourselves. And the thing is, you didn't behave this way to win Tony's praise or admiration. You did this for the reasons Tony always did, because it was just the right thing to do. So as you wake up tomorrow, and every tomorrow after that, I ask you to approach your day as Tony reminded us to approach each game, to play hard, to go after it, take risks, take pride in what you do, to play fair, to live your life with humility and compassion, to have fun, to express joy, to dance badly, but most importantly, to love. Thank you.
Our next guests are some of Tony's oldest friends. Tony and Ted May enjoyed a friendship since childhood, which continued on as couples with their growing families. The May family traveled to the Olympics in 1996 to cheer on Tony and the women's soccer team. Steve Potter knew Tony during high school and then became connected for life with a group of Wethersfield families that included the DiCiccos. Since Tony and Steve hit their 60s, the two spent more moments together than in their previous 30 years combined. Please welcome Ted May and Steve Potter.
Steve and I are here today representing Tony's Wethersfield friends, having known Tony for over 60 years. We grew up knowing Tony as a Little League teammate, a classmate, a student leader, a ski and golf buddy, a hiking companion, an Indian guide's dad. He was an incredible friend. When we were kids in Wethersfield, we were the generation that rode our bikes or walked to the playgrounds in town for pickup games of seasonal sports. And Tony excelled in all of them. Tony was our friend, neighbor, teammate. But maybe the greatest gift for our families were the moments created through our potluck dinner group over the past 40 years. No surprise, Tony was always our favorite Toastmaster. Our growing family shared backyard campouts, Vermont skiing, family trips, Indian guides weekends, Camp Jewel, and eventually our own children's weddings. Over the past few weeks, we have cried and laughed, hugged and shared, so many photos and stories about Tony and Diane and the entire DiCicco family. In the midst of everything Tony accomplished in the national and international soccer worlds, Tony remained a hometown guy, a devoted family man, and an inspiration to us all. That's the Tony we knew. He even brought the women's national team to scrimmage against Anthony's high school soccer team. We kidded that it was just another home game for Tony. Tony was an inspirational coach, a leader, a mentor, a wonderful friend, and a very, very proud husband and father. Last week, the DiCicco boys said their dad was a force, and he certainly was. But Diane, Anthony, Drew, Alex and Nicole, and Nick, Tony so loved you and was incredibly proud of each and every one of you. And it's no surprise that you too have become one collective force. We love you all.
Tribute to Tony, we quickly realized that speaking about him would only take us so far. We concluded that speaking through music, especially music that I thought Tony would love, was the way to go. So here's how two old friends saw the amazing life of Tony DiCicco unfold before our very eyes.
Thank you.
Steve. Now to the oldest of the four boys, who has always, I think, been a wonderful representation of the family, has been our conduit for so many of us in the soccer world and beyond, and represented the family with such grace. And when you see the photos there, it's a spitting image of Tony Sr., Anthony DiCicco.
I listen to people talking about him, and from my lens, he's an enigma. Who the hell was this guy? You know, he's this mountaineering, skiing, goalkeeper, baseball, infielder, father. He was so much. And I don't know if anyone else feels this, but what I'm feeling sitting here is we're just scratching the surface. I know from talking to the SoccerPlus guys at the game last night, or talking to some of the former players, or his teammates, the Springfield College guys who are out there, we're just scratching the surface. And that's a hell of a testament in its own right. The opportunity here is to acknowledge something exceptional, something truly exceptional that we've all been a part of. And I honestly believe that if we came to this room or went to the top of Talcott Mountain earlier today, or went to a Breakers game, or get on the golf course, and we didn't tell Tony stories, and we didn't have any of these formalities, that we would still feel exactly what we're feeling now. That connectedness, the true infusion of him into who we are. And for me, being named Anthony DiCicco in 1982 wasn't a problem. By 1996, it had gotten a little more challenging. The story behind that is I'm not named after my father. I'm named after both my grandfathers. I'm Anthony Edward DiCicco. He's Anthony Dominic DiCicco. And it sets a little bit of a stage, and you saw some of the pictures, for the significance that both Dad and Mom placed in the sanctity of their families, and what that meant in terms of what they envisioned the life that they were going to create for themselves. And his parents were exceptional. And they raised four exceptional children. And about 10 years ago, I spoke at my grandfather's, Anthony Dominic DiCicco Sr.'s funeral. And I came off the podium and we sat down next to Dad and I said, that's the hardest thing I've ever done. And he said, I know, I'm really proud of you. He's proud of me, but he's proud of everyone. He's proud of people he's never met. And, you know, when I look at my Uncle Bob and my Aunt Judy and my Aunt Joan and Uncle George and Uncle Rain and Uncle John, what I see are all of the qualities that he possesses as well. And the ability for him to take that and manage it through soccer, through the medium of soccer, into what we are all experiencing today is something that I hope I never take for granted. And I like to think that I haven't, because ultimately as mom and dad grew the family, they had to find a way to get me out of the house. So most of the time it was just sending me along with dad wherever he was going, to soccer clinics or to training or to whatever it was. And by 1996, it had gotten so hard because Nick was 5 at that point that I just became the intern for the national team. And they just sent me to training every day. And I was, I'm sure, for the SoccerPlus people, for Mick and Big Bird and the others who are out there, I'm sure I was a pest and I'm sure that I was in the way and, you know, causing all kinds of problems. And he coached me through it. He taught me how to be a son, how to absorb, to be a sponge to all the things that he knew, but also that he was learning. And the things that I'm going to miss the most will be the conversations about whatever it is in that moment that's resonating. And that ran the gamut for us. From what was happening in the Arsenal transfer market to the tactical organization of North Korea. When Lisa and I were in Papua New Guinea in November, we scored on North Korea. Sweden and Brazil were not able to. We scored on North Korea, and the email he sent that night, because he was waking up at 4 a.m. to watch games so he could scout for us from halfway around the world, was very, it was 2 lines. And it just said, I'm proud of you. You've done something incredible. And that's the sentiment. Dad, I'm so freaking proud of you. You've done something incredible. Sorry. Now, everyone in this room understands that none of that would even be remotely possible without the woman sitting here in the front row. Not even close. Not even close. When he spoke about mom, he spoke about all the roles she carried, and I really like the some of the lists that, you know, the terms we've heard. You know, one of them was his energy coach. Fake Dan, she's still waiting for her back payments on that one. But well, what she was she was the anchor. She was the anchor. She was the rock, the cornerstone that allowed him to go off on his tether and do something here, which was the stories that we're recounting tonight, and then come back and have the sanctity of the space they created together. And like I said, I got to bear witness to a whole lot of it. And there's, you know, like I said, we're scratching the surface. You know, we haven't talked about the Reds tonight. Let's talk about those Connecticut Reds. They need an honorable mention, because we've got some VIPs in the back, I think. But the
The number of things that he was able to do are dwarfed by the gift that I was given by having three younger brothers. And about 4 months ago, in the Champions Clinic, Mom's birthday, we were sitting in the living room, and we knew that he was dealing with. But we, truly, until the last day, if this guy had gotten up and gone and run a marathon, I wouldn't have been surprised. And what he said as we sat there in March was, the thing that I am most proud of is the relationship between the brothers. And now, over the past number of years, we have our sister Nicole in that as well. But what's happened over the course of our family's evolution is that, as much as it's a cliche to talk about a team as family or a program as family, it's not cliche when it's true. And in every instance, every team that he touched, from Springfield College to the Connecticut Wildcats, Rhode Island Oceaneers, SoccerPlus, U20s, full team, Breakers, Reds, and I'll say that although it was an experience wrought with challenges, the opportunity to coach with him in our club and to see the number of exceptional young men and women that came through the program and to live that with him every day, it is all our family. You are all part of our family. And so, of course, you can hear it in my voice and see the tears that are running down my face, that there is sadness. Excuse me. We are sad. We feel the absence. Lotto talked about his presence and what a larger-than-life figure he was. But beyond that, we are so grateful. We are so grateful. Drew said it aptly, the perfection is in the imperfections. Perfection is in the imperfections. This story isn't nearly as good if you guys won in 95, right? The opportunity for him to reinvent himself time and again, and to take on so many roles and to wear so many masks, and to impact so many lives, and to connect with so many people. How can I feel anything but incredibly, incredibly blessed? Being Tony and Diane's son is a great privilege of my life. And that doesn't change. He would smite me if I didn't take the time to thank everyone who's made this incredible weekend possible and happen. Dana Schoenwetter, Thom Meredith, Peter O'Keefe, Mick D'Arcy, the NSCA, I know Lynn Bernie Manuel is here representing them. Incredible. There's a whole other group of people who are organizing golf for tomorrow, the Breakers from yesterday. So, cast of thousands, thank you from the deepest place in our heart. I look forward to hearing more stories. I think that the world is a lesser place without Dad in it. The opportunity is to light a fire with the love that he left behind. And if we find strength and courage to do that, there's a hell of a lot of love. I can tell you, we've been experiencing it nonstop for the past 3 weeks. There's a hell of a lot of love. But, as Anson's talked about, the leadership and the courage it takes to have vision. One of the books that he left me, he would always be leaving me books or handing me books. Leadership Moment by Michael Eustein, right, is leadership is vision plus action, right? And he was able to do that. He was able to recognize that. So now, I don't know where we go from here, but I know that we have to decide to go with
the same commitment and belief and love that he went everywhere he went. So from the family, thank you all for being here sincerely. The legacy continues, like I talked about, through the club, through the camps, through the national team players, through the Raiders, through all of it. But we want to leave you with one of his players, a very close family friend, Kirby O'Keefe, who I want to tell a quick story about Kirby to illustrate the impact that he's had on how other people view their lives. In 2008 or 2009, I forget the years now, I was on the stage with him, and we were addressing the club as we were going through some relatively tumultuous times. And Kirby's team was about to enter the ECNL. The ECNL was brand new. Kirby's team was about to enter the ECNL. And the team had to decide whether to go with their coach to another club or to stay and enter this uncharted territory. And it was Kirby and her co-captain who stood up at a team meeting and said, "This is our club. This is who we play for. This badge is what matters to me." And as a result, that team stayed and ended up having a very successful 4 years through high school. And so it's my privilege and honor to bring Kirby up to read the passage that probably resonated the most for him, and I'm sure all the national teamers will remember it, to close the ceremony. Thank you guys all for being here. Very much.
Is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We are born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our own fear, our presence automatically liberates others.
These are for you, my dear.
Yes!
This was a game time decision. And the only thing I want to leave you with
almost 40 years with this man. As you heard from everyone here, his ability to shine his light on me created something so magical that I would have followed him, and I did. Anywhere he wanted to go. And I lost myself in it, only to find myself again, to never lose myself again. And I wouldn't change a moment. Thank you so much for being here and being part of our life.
The immense impact that Tony had, but it doesn't happen with that woman right there, Di. I mean, you are and were not only his strength, his rock, and as Nikki so aptly pointed out, his boss, Di. So thank you. And for the four boys, thank you for sharing Tony with us and allowing us. I just feel so lucky, and I know I speak for all of us here. I feel so lucky to have been touched by him in our lives. So thank you. Okay, a couple of housekeeping items. Refreshments from the back. Thanks to the NSCAA. Mia donated all the cookies. There's also a remembrance book that the family would like you to sign. And finally, a tribute video that ESPN put together. Mia talked about the phrase that Tony always wrote on the bottom of every whiteboard before every game was play hard, play fair, and have fun. And the only thing I would say is, as we've heard today, play Tony's spirit forward. I think that is our goal, is to continue to spread his love. Thank you for honoring Tony with this wonderful celebration, and here is the ESPN tribute video.
Coming of age and now winning gold medals. you guys will always be remembered as pioneers in the game of soccer and women's sports. I was thinking to myself, okay, when Randy makes this, I want to hug my staff. They got to the peak. They changed the face of women's sports and women's soccer forever. And now there's new peaks for the next generations to accomplish.
We're more experienced. North Korea is young, the youngest team in the tournament, so they need to use their experience if they're going to get by. But don't be pesky, and they play with a chip on their shoulder.
Soccer so serious that we take the fun out of it.